Well, good afternoon, everyone. I'm here to present you a story of women's cricket in India. Well, if we talk about women's cricket, the main thing which comes to my mind, which just happened right now, was the 2017 World Cup. Although I would like to add one line that defines me as a player, is public speaking was never my cup of tea because I had my bat in my hand. And I will relate this line later in my talk when I will end it. So coming back to the 2017 World Cup, India were doing well, and for that reason I'm standing in front of you and delivering this speech. And you are about to witness a story of women's cricket which is not familiar to many people. So what happened at 2017 World Cup? Although we lost, but we took pride, we took glory, we mesmerized the world and charmed everyone. So that's really made me proud standing here as a women cricketer. I am Jaya Sharma. I did not start as a cricketer. Let me just introduce you to real Jaya Sharma, who started at the tender age of 10 and started the sporting career with playing Federation Cup football tournament at the age of just 10 years. And then going on to represent hockey state team, Delhi State, in national tournaments. And while I was juggling between the games, I somehow knew about the cricket team. So I took part in that as well. So I will just tell you about myself, because as a women cricketer, we are used to doing it. Not now, but yes, earlier it was, so it's in my blood. So I was the left-hand opener for the team, Indian team, and highest individual run scorer, that is 138 not out against Pakistan in Karachi. And that record stood for almost 16 years. I was the third highest run getter for the country after Mithali Raj and Anjum Chopra. And recipient of first BCCI Woman Player of the Year Award in 2007. And last but not the least, Rajiv Gandhi awardee for Delhi State. So this was me in front of you. But the cricket we played was actually sown, the seeds were sown by some greats in the women's cricket fraternity. The names like Diana Dilji, Shantaranga Swami, Sandhya Agarwal, and many more. So they sowed the seeds, and then we were the lot who were there to water it with our blood and our sweat. So it is somewhere around, I made my debut in 2002, and we were under the umbrella of WCAI, Women's Cricket Association of India. So we had very limited resources back then. We used to travel unreserved near toilets, sitting for many hours and reaching the destination. We used to stay in dormitories, sleep over the mattresses with just fans over our head. And we used to play on the grounds which were not very much suitable for competitive sport. And that's why I risked our early age with the chances of injury. And that what happened to me. So it cut my career short, but that's fine, as well as I'm contributing in any way towards women cricket. So I would like to take you on a journey with me today towards a year back in 2005 World Cup. So we were 30 people who were training for a campaign called World Cup in 2005 under the WCCI. With limited resources, yes, but we were committed. Because there were nothing like monetary gains, so we were not focused on that part. We were just focused on to play good cricket for the country. So we trained hard, and the day came when the journey had to start to South Africa. The journey of the first ever World Cup I was going to play after making my debut. So it's an interesting one. I guess I won't let you get bored. So it starts with the way we landed in South Africa. We have been taken to the place, we have been put up. So there were apartments, and those apartments were in building, and those buildings were in rows. So I guess we were the second or the third team to land there. So we've been asked to take our luggages to the assigned building, and that was a part of our game, so we never bothered. But to our surprise came a very weird experience. When we got to our apartments, so there were no ACs and no fans. AC is a luxury, I can understand, but fans are the necessity. And if you are playing World Cup, and that too in South Africa, I mean, this much you demand. This is something a sports person needs for the recovery, the rest, proper rest. So our manager went and spoke to the liaisoning team, saying that, you know, how is that possible that we are the second or the third team to land here? And how come we have been assigned the last apartment in the row? So they said that, you know, the first two buildings are reserved. So my manager asked them why they are reserved, who reserved them. So the answer we got was that those buildings, two buildings, were reserved for the English teams like Australia, England, New Zealand, South Africa. And those two buildings were full of amenities, not fan, but the AC too. Before this incident, I guess when we were preparing back in India for the World Cup, we wanted to do well as a team as also. But it was a campaign for us. But after this incident, it got us, all the team, all the superstar, on the same page and turned it into a fierce unit and made the campaign our mission for the World Cup. Because that was not accepted, and we wanted to showcase our talent by playing a good quality cricket. And this was, the turning point and the boon in disguise that worked for us. We got into the frame of mind that we will prove them. And we utilized our maximum potential. So we started taking one game at a time. We had to play 9 games in a row. That was the league stage. So we took the game one by one, and I will tell you why this is so important telling you. Cricket is a team game, and that World Cup proved us that it is a team game. Because not one person was informed, but in each game, one or the other person was clicking for us. And I guess that's the best sign of a unit. So that was the best part. We gained the momentum by continuing to win one game at a time. And then we had our last league game against the mighty Australians. So we were bit tense because the Aussies are known to play ruthless cricket, and of course the bit and the, you know, the athleticism is much much better than what we have in India. So I guess they consciously or unconsciously intimidating as they did with us by putting us in those buildings. So, but fortunately or unfortunately, that match got washed off, and that was the match which has to decide that which spot India will take in top four. So we got to know that we are through semi-finals in 2005 World Cup. But sadly, there were no news back home. Nobody was aware that such event is taking place and our women team is doing such wonders. So few journalists call, and I guess for us that was much more. So at least we were like, at least they took us. But the hardest step was in front of us. The semi-finals was the clash between the defending champions of last year World Cup, and that was the New Zealanders. Although we gained momentum in our series, but they play a different quality of cricket, because their upbringing and our upbringing, their atmosphere, their training, their regimes, everything is so much different from what we have or had. So the match began, and we put up some 190 odd runs on the board. So when the lunch happened, the break happened, we all got together and said to ourselves, this is the time we have to do it, or it will be never. So we got to the ground and started the process. To gain the momentum early in the game, we got the first wicket in first or the second over, and that was a run out. Fortunately, it was me on the point region, because I always fielded at point position, and it recalled me that I have been given a title of Lady Jockey Rhodes. For my batting skills, I was left an opener. I have been given the title of Lady Virendra Sehwag by the media. But that is a different part. But that run out gave us momentum that we needed to go on. And at that point of time, we smelled blood. And we went on, and finally, we were there. Through to the finals. Sadly, and this pain never can go from any one of our hearts. The people who were the main reason behind it, the main reason behind the success, the unsung warriors, likes of Neetu David, Anju Chopra, Mitali Raj, Himlata Kala, myself, Nushi Nalgadi, Rumeli Dara, Amita Sharma. But anyways, we had to move on. And then BCCI came into picture and took us under their wing. So the infrastructure got better, facilities starting to get better. Of course, not at par with men cricket, but that was much, much, much more for us. But that thing, the thing that happened with 2017 World Cup Finals and 2005 World Cup Finals if I see through my eyes as a cricketer, we are standing still in 2005, even we are in 2017, with all the resources, all the central contracts, every facility given to the players. It's not a complaint. I just want to bring awareness, because this thing really intrigued me to go much deeper into what affects human excellence, what affects human behavior, because we are not cricketers or sportsperson that was born. We were human beings first. So I dig deep, and it was easy for me on my part, as my educational background is of science. So I went into the research, took many courses from many countries, and got to know the difference, the cutting edge idea, the human excellence secret. And that was deep in the brain. And I can say that just because we lack their awareness in 2005, and sadly in 2017 as well, we are still the runners. But that gave me a purpose for my life, because I was clueless when I retired from my game due to injuries, due to playing on conditions that were not suitable at our time, on the hard grounds. So I got 3 knee surgeries, many injuries of shoulder, tennis elbow. But what can we do to prevent that? So right now I'm working as a mind conditioning coach and keen on working on the grassroots level. Because if I took 22 years between those 22 yards, I don't want the young sports person, talented sports person, to take those many years to reach to their maximum potential. Maximum potential of every person is the same. Might be someone it's 100%, might be someone it's 70, or might be someone it's 30. But the question arises is the person with 70% of potential is tapping that 70%, or he is doing somewhere close to 30 or 40%? What about that gap? How to fill that gap? Because my as I am international cricketer and played at domestic level as well. So I started connecting the dots, because there was something which was lacking. And I tried to find the reason, and I am now working on the young minds to train them better, to give them awareness of their potential. And sometimes in life, it happened with me as well. Someone with a potential of 70% does not have a vision. So I am trying to bridge that gap between my practical experience of cricket that I've lived through those that 22 yards distance, and trying to bridge it with the knowledge I'm getting now. So this is for all of us, not just cricket, but in any endeavor of life. We have to tap our maximum potential, and for that we need awareness that what is our maximum potential is. And that is right possible. That is possible. That's how we are not doing so much at the Olympics level. We can get much more medals, but we aren't. But now, I'm spreading this awareness, and I'm happy to be here in front of you and sharing that. Thank you.